presence. I've got to watch what I say because I'm going to be checked on for accuracy at every turn. Let me tell you a few things about myself that you may not know. I'm a product of the rural schools of southwestern Nebraska. To be specific, District 74, Pennsylvania School, Furnace County, 6 miles west of Beaver City. I went to that school for 7 years. The reason I went seven was when I was in the third grade. I was the only one in third grade, so I did third and fourth grade the same year. Then my folks moved to Frontier County and into the middle of a little class four school district. I thought when we moved up there that I'd get to go to the Nebraska School of Agriculture and continue my music lessons with a cornet. A two-teacher rural high school, and I rode a horse 3 years through all kinds of weather to this little school. And I was, you know, when you have lemons, you make lemonade. And I made the best that I could with what I had and received a pretty good education there. It was a school that provided entertainment for the neighborhood. So there were all kinds of three-act plays, all that kind of thing. So that's kind of where I came from. I had two inspirations in my life. One of them was my Uncle Don, one of my dad's younger brothers, who was a stylish gentleman, a teacher, and I wanted to grow up and be like Uncle Don. Well, he kept his hair longer than I did. The other one was Mr. Mills, who I had for second, third, and fifth grade in Pennsylvania school. I wrote a history of the district simulated by Earle Wiltse, who in 1957 developed a history of the district to that point in time. And so when I finished my work, I thought if somebody doesn't record all the stuff that took place in the 50s and 60s, it'll be lost forever. It isn't. My other source was a textbook that I had in graduate school at the university on the history of education in this country. So, what I'm going to do today, I'm going to set a platform here to go. I'm going to talk about the things that really happened that set the American schools on the path that they've followed since, starting in 1778 and ending up in 1917. And then I'm going to go to the superintendents, three of them, who are the legends that created the district here. R.J. Barr, C. Ray Gates, and Earle Wiltse. I ran across this just the other day, and it sets a framework for the things I'm going to tell you. Origin of our type attitudes toward education. Religious origin of our schools. School with us. As with other European countries from which our early settlers came, arose largely as children of the church. From instruments of religion, they have changed gradually into important instruments of the state. The first schools in America were clearly the fruits of the Protestant revolts in Europe. The reformers everywhere had insisted upon the necessity of the knowledge of the Gospels as a means of personal salvation. This meant, carried to its logical conclusion, that each child, girls as well as boys, should be taught to read so they might become acquainted with the commandments of God and learn what was demanded of them. Not being able to recognize their ideals of life and worship in the old homelands, large numbers of religious congregations left Europe and came to America. Here they settled in the wilderness, set up civil government, and began life anew. Among other things, they brought with them their European ideas as to religion, the training of children, and hence a European background lies behind all the beginnings of American education. I think that's particularly appropriate with the German heritage that this area received when people moved here in 1957 to live and to raise their families and go ahead. So this is kind of the platform that I'm going on today. The War of the Revolution was over, and there were territories west of the Alleghenies that wanted to join the Union. Well, the Continental Congress was in session in 1787. Now, this is not the Congress we know today. This is the Continental Congress that ruled the colonies at the time of the Revolution. So they set out conditions of statehoods. This is important because they required that every state, in order to be admitted, had to set aside sections of land in every township. Township is six sections square, to use for the training of children to get an education in grades 1 through 8. This is the only nation in the world ever to build schools that kids could walk to. We take pride in that, those of us who attended those schools. Now somebody's going to say, oh, how about the 13 colonies? I don't know what happened there, but I'm assuming they would have the same thing happen to them. At any rate, that's the first point I want to make. Second one, in higher education, Harvard University was founded in 1636. That's 16 years after the Pilgrims first landed in Massachusetts. Other universities followed. We skip forward to 1961, 62, somewhere in that realm. President Lincoln signed a bill creating the Morrill Act, which was intended to have the states create colleges that served the home arts, the mechanical arts, all the fields of agriculture that you can think about. That passed. It had been vetoed by Buchanan, his predecessor, but it created a system of colleges across this country. Military training was also a part of this. Joe Cook here has got lots of training in one of those institutions. In Nebraska, the Nebraska School of Agriculture came under the same region structure that the university has. Other places, Kansas State, all those that have state after their name, were separate colleges. Guess how much land was set aside to endow these colleges? $11,367,832 were set aside in the whole country to do that. It was allotted on the basis of the total number of the representatives in the House of Representatives and in Congress, or in the Senate. A very, very important legislation for the future of this country at the collegiate level, because they were beginning to realize that the classical education they had grown up with needed something else if they were going to be successful in this new land. The next bill that was really important, a judge in 1872 in Kalamazoo, Michigan, in a trial, approved the use of public funds to build high schools. Now that gap had been filled by private sources, but there was a ferment to get practical with life in the new world. So, and the last one of this group is in 1917, the Smith-Hughes Act, approved using tax funds to build high schools, to offer vocational education in high schools. So the table is set for future development of education in this country, and all states succeed. The first schooling in this community was in 1864. And between 1864 and 1882, there were lots of efforts to try to keep up with the population. And R.J. Barr became superintendent in 1882, and he was superintendent until 1922. That's a long time. That's a long, long time. And here's what Dr. Barr and Mr. Barr did. He built a new high school at Walnut and 10th Street. He improved the old building that had been the high school, dive school across the lot from across the way from the Leader Cramps. Howard School, which is was in a park over here, Lincoln School, Jefferson School, Westlawn School, and a small school in Wasmer. You'll notice all that, most of that took place north of the tracks in those days. When the Smith-Hughes Act was passed, two wings were added to the high school on 10th and Walnut for vocational education. We get to things that are kind of interesting now. In those days, the custodian and his family lived in the basement of the school. Because there had to be somebody there to take care of the furnace, or else there would have been broken pipes all over the place.
Makes sense.
With that came the odors from the kitchen. Can you imagine smelling burnt scorched pancakes all day? In the rooms above you, or liver and onions, or whatever else that went on with that. That would have been really interesting, right? Mr. Barr cooperated with William Solly to write a history of Hall County. He was a scholar as well. He had developed a very excellent curriculum with the help of teachers for the elementary schools. And he had a two-track program for the second, one for college and a separate curriculum for those who were not going to college. He, in essence, created this school system. He left the district in 1922 and passed away in 1923. He was replaced by C. Ray Gates. Dr. Gates got his doctor's degree from Teachers College, Columbia University, New York City. How he ever came to be out here, I don't know, except that it was a job. But he came with that background and was very, very respected. He changed the school district from a K-8-9-12 district to K-6. Oh, by the way, in between all this, there was a German who started kindergarten. His name was Frebel. And there wasn't any legislation that affected this, but all of a sudden, schools began to have kindergarten. And there were other ideas from other scholars, Pestalozzi and some of those, for example, but that's the one that carried through. Okay, the junior high school was coming into being at that particular time because that particular age group of children needed a different environment than upper elementary and high school. So 7, 8, and 9 became standard for years and years. The new high school, 5th and Elm, the specifications for that school were developed by people from Columbia University, Teachers College. There were hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of high schools built in the 20s. They all resemble, time and time and time again, senior high school at 5th and Elm, just because of the influence of those particular architects from that time. Now, Dr. Gates was not an easy person to work for. Example, when I became principal at Jefferson, I found all these books from the 20s, John Dewey, Kilpatrick, a whole bunch of them, in the library. So I asked Mildred Neitzel, who had taught with Dr. Gates, what all those books were doing in the office. She said, well, Gerald, Dr. Gates had Saturday meetings, and the purpose of those meetings, and he took role too, was to study those authors about the new progressive education that Dewey and Kilpatrick championed and this kind of thing. And woe be unto you if you didn't work at that. And typically he would start in and say, well, I really left on page so-and-so, would so-and-so, would you begin there, and we'll continue with our studies of this particular place. He also had the misfortune of having to deal with the Depression, which was terrible. And he helped the school survive, but in order to do that, he really had to cut some corners, and people learned to do things without what they thought they couldn't get along without, but they did. We expect the teachers to be well-informed. When he converted to this system, the old high school became Walla Junior High, and Barr Junior High was built. Now, there's an argument that hasn't been settled yet between us and Lincoln, that who had the first junior high? We claim we did, they claim they did. Who did? I don't know. It doesn't make a whole lot of difference now. Gates did build a new Wasmer and a new Dodge in Eastern GI. People got really upset because they had that Dodge was clear out in the country, for heaven's sake. Why does somebody put a school way out there? He visited classrooms on a regular basis and had high expectations for all teachers. May Clark, who taught Lincoln, who was principal of Lincoln School, visited her one time, and he left a report for her. She demands, she will not settle for assertions, she wants proof. Then, we move to Dr. Earle Wiltse, who took his place in 1944. I met Dr. Wiltse when I was a freshman in 1942 at McCook Junior College. McCook was one of the four junior colleges in the state at that time. They were college prep schools. The only terminal courses in those schools was business education and teaching certificates. We were the 2-year thing, and that's what I got when I started teaching in McCook. But he inspired me while I was there because he spoke to the freshmen a number of times in orientation stations and this kind of thing. So when I graduated from the U, I naturally applied here and had a job. Now, I didn't know what I was really getting into, except I knew that he was, I went to school for a year and resumed school at the same salary as I had in the cook, you know. But I thought there was future here. By that time, he had a preschool workshop of 4 days, and guess what was the theme for the first year? The air age was the finest, and every teacher in the district who wanted to got a ride in an airplane during that course. United Airlines and Transworld Airlines were spending hundreds of thousands of dollars to educate the public about the future of flight and what it meant for this country. I had had a taste of that in summer 1950 when I was told I was going to have a flight down to Omaha and get to go through the United Kitchens down there and have lunch. So I was one of those that, when I would think of more 10 or 12 people out of 200 that ever been up in the air. Now they just didn't send them up to look around and do things. There were two systems trying to develop irrigation in this section of the Platte River. And there were lots of things there. Now, this continued through 1959 when Dr. Wiltse left the system. The who's who in American education addressed the teachers in this community. I don't know what it did for other people, but it broadened my viewpoint. It gave me respect for things coming. It gave me perspective, and it gave me desire. There was Dr. Wiltse had Paul Mark, professor of New York University, Columbia University, had formed a nationwide network of schools who were dedicated to school improvement. And they were coast to coast, associated public school systems, APSS. One of the precepts of this group was We'd have better schools if teachers would share their know-how with one another. And the avenue for doing this was a little publication that my principal produced called GI Know-How, or GI Know-How. And it was tricks and this kind of thing you could do for instruction. So in 1957, after I finished my graduate degree at the university, I was in his office one day, and Martha Green, who was my principal, had told me she was not going to do that anymore. So he braces me up and said, "Jerry, how would you like to do that? I'll give you $400 to go to Columbia University to get a background in that this summer." I said, "Can I take my wife?" "Yeah, but you've got to pick that up." So here I go to Teachers College in the summer of 1957 to find out how to do GI Know-How. Well, I formed a committee, and I made awfully sure that I had a grammarian on Irene Abergavenny, so to speak. It turned out to be Andy Ewing, who taught Latin at Barr Junior High School. She knew why I had her on there, and she was very professional about it. Because I published that and sent it to all the schools in the system, now, clear across the country, I got mail back. And so as principal at Jefferson School, I was getting something every week, it seemed to me like, that I would initial and then circulate to some teachers. I had a four-drawer file of those publications when I was the principal at Jefferson School. He passed a bond issue for $4 million to build a new high school, changed the old high school into Walden Junior High. The principal wasn't too happy because he didn't get all that he wanted. But a new Howard came out of that, a new Gates, and a brand new Newell. So that's two schools. Dr. Wiltse used a broad array of citizens to develop the education specifications for the high school. It was well enough done that we became an all-American city in 1955 when the high school opened. The first one that we were awarded with. Because of him, this happened. The high school was a state-of-the-art building with a curriculum to meet. Wasmer, Jefferson, Westlawn, and Dodge and Adaptations plus these three schools, Gates, Newell, and Newell. Let's see. We're just about through with Dr. Wiltse. But I want to say this. He formed a council here in Nebraska in collaboration with the University of Nebraska to have a council of schools that would meet on a regular basis. And one part of these meetings were pretty appealing, a week in Estes Park. Who wouldn't want to join that group? So small schools benefited from this study that he initiated through this. Another thing that he asked, please really do everything you can to release the potential in the children that you're responsible for. And I promise that I will help you receive your potential as a teacher or as an administrator. This began something that the present administration can't begin to understand. Grand Island was a place to be if you were on the way up. And if you could get in here, your future was guaranteed. The plum position, actually, was the vice president, who was the vice principal at the high school. Everybody that came through wound up being a doctor, being a superintendent in the other district, a professor, and this kind of thing. I think he's the greatest superintendent the state ever had, but I have a bias and a reason for it. Now, those are the three legends that I consider to be. Anybody's welcome to pick out theirs, but these people were real leaders. Now we're approaching the 1960s. when all kinds of things broke loose. In 1958, the Russians put up a satellite about the size of a basketball, and all of a sudden, we were playing second fiddle in the world. And so the NDEA acts were passed, awarding scholarships to people to get graduate degrees. There were special courses offered. You could get money for science equipment and all this kind of thing. But we had to catch up with the Russians, and that really, really, really kicked a bunch of things into motion. Now, over the next 15, 20 years, I'm going to go through a list of items that happened in almost trip hammer fashion. First of all, expansion of special services. Before this time, speech therapy was the only specialized service that existed in the schools. And the State Department of Education, the legislature, always used statistics 5-3 years old, and used that as the basis for how the money was allocated. Pretty forward-looking. Educational television came into being, and we joined with that and were quite active in it. There were vocal and instrumental programs that were added on. String started. All schools had band and orchestra. Elementary libraries were developed. Because the school, Howard was the only school who had anything that even looked like a library, but its collection was not up to date. So we got a $50,000 grant from the state to develop a model library there. It addressed all learning modalities, hearing, seeing, feeling, the whole thing. Elementary art and elementary school breakfast and lunch. Well, the breakfast didn't first, but there was lunch. Then here are things that happened event-wise. The GI Bill. Why was the GI Bill? Well, how did that affect us? A lot of men were able to get college degrees and graduate degrees who became teachers. That's a very positive thing. Brown versus Topeka, the Supreme Court decision. Who knows what that was? Separate but equal was done for. And we've been fighting to correct that error ever since. The 1958 Defense Education Act I mentioned. Then here was one that just shocked everybody. And it led to things that nobody had ever dreamed. The 14th Amendment had two provisions in it. One was that equal protection under the law, guaranteed to every person, and due process. Washington was the only place that had that in place. There was a case that went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said it goes to every governmental subdivision, whether it's Washington, D.C., or Bentley, Nebraska. Well, that was a shock, because it kicked into action equal protection under the law. It said the handicapped children were not getting their fair share of the pot. And all this kicked a bunch of things into motion. The 19 Civil Rights Act and the Elementary and Secondary Act, with six titles for project, was Lyndon Johnson's baby, but let's see, Head Start was John Kennedy's. Susan Weiss and I started Head Start here in Nebraska in 1965. And we had problems with the Board of Education with money coming directly from Washington here, because they didn't want Washington telling us anything to do. But it took 10 years to justify what Head Start did for people. After 15 years, the research showed that in apples to apples and oranges to oranges comparison, that Head Start students with 1 year of Head Start had better attendance at school. Two, the graduation rate was higher. There was an attitude towards school that was more positive. And go on and on and on here, just the influence early on of 1 year of being different. Having that stimulation had that effect, which says something about The ages of 3 to 5 are the time when attitudes and feelings are developed either negatively or positively. Well, there was a special ed pastor in the state of Nebraska, ahead of the feds. LB 403 in 1974 outlined a comprehensive bill of needs that had to be carried out. And I remember giving up Christmas vacation to work with people in this area to develop a plan to incorporate this. And Grand Island became a service unit to a lot of schools in this area that had handicapped children of varying degrees, and we're still doing some of that. Ron Combs and those people did a great job. The only thing was they'd have one position today and a different one tomorrow. That got to be perplexing. The Elementary and Secondary Act had 6 titles. The first one was Title I, Improvement of Reading. I can't think of the names of all of the titles, but Title III had to do with innovative projects. And if you went far enough with them, they were validated and then were public, available publicly. We had some of those moments. We got a $67,000 grant to take children to Stuart Museum, an art experience and an educational experience. Every grade had a different curriculum out there. And we had buses that transport the kids there. That program still exists. And as a matter of fact, that is the heart of Stuart Museum's program. But an art teacher's idea got that started, and they eventually took it over. Those things kind of things happen. In 1978, the Federals put out a special needs program with $9 million for Nebraska, and we began to focus upon literally birth to age 5. Of children born with a handicap. And just the act of meeting with their parents, working with developmentally to see if the children were progressing, really, really did a lot of good. So we enter into the 1960s, where things happened at practically racehorse speed. Hang on a sec. Dr. Glenn Lester became superintendent in 1959, and a lot of things happened in his. All these programs came to fruition under his leadership. And a bond issue built a new bar and a conifer, plus an addition to gates. There was a comprehensive review of curriculum K-12 in 6 core areas, starting in 1952 and finishing in 1965. That resulted in department chairman being created to keep people in tow, new course alignments, this kind of thing. American history adjusted from being taught 3 times with 2 years separating it, 5th grade, 8th grade, and then 10th grade, to 9 and 10, back to back. And we weren't even getting into the 20th century with our teaching of history in this community because of that. NBA grants for use for math and science, we got a planetarium at senior high school. Marv Maurer came as assistant superintendent for finances, and I can't begin to tell you how many teachers got fellowships to advance their studies. An index system for salaries, make Grand Island competitive in no time at all. And we were able to attract very, very capable people, people with experience, to fill key positions. The nature of the candidate changed. All of a sudden, money wasn't as important as it was in help to helping people. And I credit John Kennedy for this because of what he said. Don't ask what your country can do for you. What can you do for your country? But anyway, Glenn Lindstrom got a lot of things done. He was very quiet. He made some very critical mistakes that eventually cost him his job over the Northwest High Fracas. And that was too bad. But at that time, schools were being financed. 95% of the money came from local taxes. And it wasn't until later, in about 67 or 68, that the income tax or the sales tax came in, and we began to get state aid. As a matter of fact, that increased over 10 years from $1 million to $11 million. We're getting there, folks. Dr. Cliffdale came to replace Dr. Neal in 1974-79. Cliff got things straightened out, and I can remember him saying, well, how do you do this? And so I said, well, this is the policy. He said, is it written down? No, it isn't policy. So I don't know how many hours we spent developing policy. I know I spent a lot of minutes with Virginia Berry and Dr. Bosley going on policy. When you got it through with them, it was passage by the board was easy. It was an enjoyable experience. Those people were interested in what was taking place in school and were very, very objective and direct about it. My position as assistant superintendent for curriculum personnel, certified personnel, was created at that time. He also made some appointments. Coordinator of media services, evaluation, Joe Fitzgerald, and then when he was out of there. Department chairman of junior high as well as senior high school. Blessed Mary's, the Blessed Sacrament St. Mary's closed. And we had problems, of course, in absorbing those children. But we got that done. Ann Campbell, the State Superintendent of Public Instruction, appealed to districts all over the country to start looking at career education and helping children, students, develop careers early on to motivate them. We developed a grant for $357,000 for 3 years. And computer files were expanded to people's files. And it was a shock for teachers to know that somebody had seen what was in their files. But we got through that. A camp program was planned and started. And we were more careful with interviews and improved in that area. Cliff Dale got this system back on track in those years. There was the intensity of study for curriculum change was paramount. I was working on a doctor's degree at that time, and I was well acquainted with all research in all domains in the public system. And those teachers jumped at the opportunity of working on one of those committees because they got a chance to change the curriculum. My specialty was developing people's, improving people's knowledge so they could make intelligent decisions. Then Dr. Neal came. He was only here 5 years, but man, he was busy. Previous superintendent had lost a big bond issue, which was one of the reasons why he left the district. And so Cliff got after the community to build a new Walton Junior High. A bond issue was passed and that was started. There were alterations to, then we made major additions to Newell and to Gates. We were finally finished with putting additions on Gates. We had five additions on that school. It was starting to be a K through four thing, and it wasn't ever going to grow very good because nobody was going to build in those swamps south of the tracks there that went out to the sugar plant. Dr. Neal did a lot of things to boost morale in this district. He congratulated teachers systematically, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, so on. They got a letter congratulating them. He gave attention to able students, and banquets were arranged for the top 10%. Mark Maher got in the act by developing a strategy to get people to give so that they could get a scholarship regardless of need, depending upon grades. Our school system earned national recognition for the quality of programs for special needs children. The annexation of the city brought three schools into being from out west. In 1973, Solly Park and Cedar Mile were also annexed, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. Dr. Dugosh came after that period of time, replacing Mike Neal. There was an extensive review of curriculum with Dr. Dugosh. They wanted an expansion of offerings, and so Japanese was suggested, and a program was started. It didn't last long. Computer services were moved from Omaha to GI. Vocational training was boosted through conferences and successful grants. 14 categorical programs were identified and approved by the board. By the way, all this Fed money was fed through states, and every category had its own set of rules. Every category had a different set of rules. Now try to manage that and keep your sanity. It was tough, believe me. Elementary counseling was approved. Dr. Dugosh successfully incorporated three schools on the west side into the system. We changed the curriculum at West Ridge by starting lead up to calculus in seventh grade, and then having algebra taught at the eighth grade, which caused a furor at Northwest High because they had to then start offering calculus at the high school level. And they really didn't think that those 40 kids from those schools out there had enough background in algebra, but they did. Dr. Dugosh was hired at the university, had a chance to leave. Now we get around to the really interesting stuff. The schools that were in. Okay, let's go to District 1. The original District 1 encompassed what was Grand Island at that time, plus the railroad yards on the east, and where the land where the sugar beet factory was on the west, and south to the north channel of the Platte. Now that's a pretty good sized piece of change. Well, GI took care of its own territory and it became District 2. But so then we had one school serving a really broad area. So it was divided into Cedar Mile and Stolly Park. Now, Mr. Stolle was a very astute gentleman. He did not want to raise taxes in the Stolle Park area. So he saw to it that the railroad yards and their value were attached to his district. Think about that. He was a scholar, all right, but he also watched out for his own. Can't blame him at all. He was legal in those days. Now, I researched the beginnings of three school systems from the date of their very first moderators meeting. Now, a rural school system had three board members. They met once a year in June to pass the budget and the plans for the next year and hire the teacher for next year. Here's where it gets interesting. And it's the one I'm going to tell you is one of the reasons why country schools fared pretty well. Each country school had to buy a little packet of material from a publishing company in Fremont, and it included budget and all this kind of thing. The one thing that I got a kick out of was they had to, there was an annual meeting with an agenda. There were blanks that had to be filled in for the agenda to be completed. The structure of the meeting was outlined in black and white with no chances for change. And that's how elementary schools were successful. Now, I used to get amused with hearing small school superintendent board members say, well, we're going to want to do what we want to in our school. Well, I didn't find that to be the case in District 74 because the teacher carried a course of study with all the details spelled out in it that had to be done. And then there was the infamous 7th and 8th grade examination when all you did in 7th and 8th grade was study to pass those examinations so you could go to high school. And so at any rate, I found that to be a really interesting thing. Now, Steve Gleason really helped me out. He found a box of things he thought I might be interested in. In them was a teacher's register from the 1890s. Now, there was a fellow by the name of Bach that was the teacher. You know, this teacher's register is out of the museum. Now, remember how when you used in the 1890s, if something was written in ink, what was used? A steel point and a bottle of ink. Here was beautiful, beautiful Spencerian writing in terms of the children's names. For example, Stolle, Timothy, Wendell, Easy, Blunt, Bach, Fabinet, Becker, and Moore families were in this school in 1882. There wasn't an error anywhere in that register, any place. Everything was, there was no blot, there was no ink spot, just beautiful Spencerian writing. Now, I want to give you the rules of the road in those days. And these are precious, they really are. It's time. The attention of teachers is called to the following extracts from the course of study and manual for undergraduate students, prepared by a committee of county superintendents, school management, and government. Quote, as the teacher is, so is the school, is a trite saying, the truth of which none can come will question. Always call and dismiss your classes in order. Counter tap the bell signals. Do not allow communication, leaving seats, going out, getting water for 2 hours without permission. See that the room is properly ventilated. 65 to 70 degrees Fahrenheit is the proper temperature. Now, can you imagine a country school trying to maintain that kind of temperature range? That's right. Don't forget to have the general exercises for the whole school each day. Use oral and general exercises for provided for each grade. For the whole,